Perhaps the most recognizable Greek monument in history, the Parthenon has withstood the ravages of about 25 centuries and continues to inspire. Join me for a program dedicated to the history, the monument, the symbol, known as the Parthenon, next on a special edition of Musical Masterworks.
Musical Masterworks, a program dedicated to the rediscovery of great symphonic, instrumental, choral, operatic, cinematic, and electronic compositions from antiquity to the present, with your host, Mike Stratis.
And good evening. Welcome to Musical Masterworks. We started tonight's program with a composition by the great Menelaos Pallandios, one of the great composers of modern Greece. And we heard his beautiful work, Prayer on the Acropolis. And it was composed in 1943 during the Nazi occupation. And we heard it performed by the Orchestra of Colors under who else? Manos Hadzidakis. So it was pretty much the setting and the feeling for starting the night off, and which is, of course, the Acropolis. And so what makes this Acropolis, in particular the Parthenon, so compelling? Consider the fact that it still continues to be in the news as the focus of the campaign to return the Parthenon marbles from the British Museum, that it draws the attention and the support of well-known international figures trying to restore the marbles to their rightful place, and that it still remains the quintessential architectural paradigm of the Western world. So let's go back and start again. Here to explain the significance of this great monument is our very own Esmeralda Mourikis. How are you, Esmeralda? Welcome back.
Hello, Mike. Good evening. It's great to be back.
Great to have you back.
Thank you.
So let's start off with the Parthenon. What's going on? Talk to me.
Well, I couldn't think of a better way to start our conversation than with a few words from the Prayer on the Acropolis by the French scholar, historian, philosopher Ernest Renan, yes, in the year 1865. When I saw the Acropolis, I saw the revelation of the divine. The ideal was revealed to me, defined on Pentelic marble. It existed only once, but it will last forever. And 38 years later, in 1903, when Renan's statue was unveiled in his hometown, Tréguet, the writer Anatole France spoke at the ceremony as if he was the goddess Athena. And among others, he said, "When the Greek spirit which brought me to this earth faded away, I left. You greeted me on my sacred Acropolis and in front of the plundered Parthenon."
Yeah. And for those of you listening, the name Anatole France, no, it's not the name of the country, even though we know it is the name of the country, but it's a specific individual, the great writer Anatole France, a man who spent a lot of his time, besides being a great author, actually researching a lot of the history and culture, of course, of the ancient Greek world. And he is known for having received the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1921. Continue, Esmeralda.
Years earlier, the author Chateaubriand visited the Acropolis, and among others, he wrote, "The clear sky and the sun of Greece showered the marbles with golden shades like the ones of the autumn leaves." Also, the novelist Flaubert in 1849 said, "I feel like praying." We have also two poets in the 19th century who wrote about Acropolis without having ever been there, Victor Hugo and John Keats, who saw the marbles in the British Museum and wrote a sonnet. Our Kosti Palama also wrote the hymn to Athena, published in 1889. And of course, we should not forget Plutarch. Ούτως επανθεί και νότις της άθικτον υπό του χρόνου διατηρούσα την όψην, ως πέρα ηθαλές πνεύμα και ψυχήν αγύρω καταμεμειγμένην των έργων εχόντων. What he means is that these monuments look always new. The passing time does not affect their appearance, as if they have an eternal spirit and an ageless soul. And indeed, the spirit, the soul, is what gives Parthenon life. And this is why every imitation failed.
Very true. Very true, Esmeralda. Mm-hmm. If I may interject for a moment, I think that pretty much captures what we know here in the United States. As impressive as the replica of the Parthenon may be in Nashville, the image is there, but it is lacking in that spirit. And I think what an appropriate time to bring that up. So yes, it's very appropriate what you just said. Please continue. Mm-hmm.
And also there is a unique, I would say, harmonious bond between the human creation and nature. And I think we need to mention that the Doric style left its mark with the Parthenon. Even when the architect Ictinos had to build another temple later in the city of Phigalia, he built it in the Ionic style.
Right. Very different perception there with the Ionic. Mm-hmm. You're right. You're absolutely right.
Yes. Yeah. Uh-huh. Let's see now what happened to the Parthenon over the years. There was an alteration on the base of the statue of Athena in 396 BC. And this information is given to us by the traveler and geographer Pausanias.
Yes, Pausanias, the traveler.
Mm-hmm. And it's also remarkable that the big earthquake in Corinth in 373 BC did not affect the Acropolis. I think it's the one that destroyed Delphi, right?
Yes, I think it is. It's the one that destroyed Delphi, but you're telling me that didn't have an effect on the Acropolis, which is quite impressive because there's not a big different distance there. I mean, yeah, substantial, but not crazy distance, I'd say.
It did not affect it at all.
Wow.
The first sacrilege took place in 296 BC. The demagogue Lahari removed the trophies of Alexander the Great, which he had dedicated to the goddess after the victory of the Granicus. And the jewels also were removed, the jewels from the statue.
Wow. Yeah. I can't understand that. Why would he want to take the trophies of Alexander the Great, who just glorified the Greek world all the way to India? If I may add, I think I had seen something about the holes from the original nails in the structure. They're still there, correct?
Mike, I remember them.
Oh, wow.
I remember them, yeah. I was impressed, but it was very, very years ago. I think it was in the late 60s or so. I still remember them.
Right, right.
In 61 AD, Nero's inscription with golden letters was placed on the Parthenon.
Oh, that Nero. He always has some way of putting himself into Greek history, whether it's the Olympic Games, he bribed every judge, or putting his letters on the Acropolis.
On the Acropolis, and especially on the Parthenon, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Around 450 AD, the statue was removed and sent to Constantinople, where it was later burned down in one of the Hippodrome fires.
I think it was during the reign of the Emperor Marcian, right? I think so.
In the 450s. Could be, I'm not sure, Mike.
Might be, okay.
It is quite impressive that the Neoplatonian philosopher Proclus saw the goddess in his dream. And his biographer Marinos writes, her statue was being removed by the ones who moved the immovable. Άγαλμα αυτής το εν Παρθενώνη τέως ιδρυμένον υπό τον και τα ακίνητα κινούντον μεταφέρετο. Let's go now to the Emperor Justinianos.
Justinian, yes.
Under the Emperor Justinianos, Parthenon was consecrated as a Christian church. It changed the name as well. Agia Sophia at the beginning, Panagia Theniotissa later.
Right.
The French archaeologist Ernest Breton mentions a destruction of the reliefs on the eastern metope. I think they opened a window or something there.
Right.
Under the Franks, Parthenon became a Latin church under the name Ecclesia de Santa Maria di Atene. But all these names faded away in the end. What was preserved was only the immortal spirit of the ancient Greek culture and its name, the Parthenon. And actually, in the 5th century BC, it was called Omegas Neos, the Grand Temple. And only in the 4th century, it was called Parthenon. We will talk about that later.
Yes, if I could just add something, Esmeralda. What I remember when I read years ago, I read Kostis Palamas's The King's Flute, I Flogera tu Vasilia. And I'll never forget that beautiful image that Palamas drew of the Parthenon as a church where he has these interesting connections between the ancient world looking in the face of the Christian world. And there, as you just said, if I hadn't read that, I wouldn't have realized that. Nobody would know. There's nothing there. So you're absolutely right. The present image of the Parthenon is still connecting with the ancient origins of that building. I think you're
correct.
Right.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And if I may also add right here, during that same Latin or Frankish period, which is from 1205 to 1458, a lot of interesting things are being done on the surface of the Acropolis. If I'm not mistaken, Otto de la Roche had been busily constructing palaces and even a very well-known large tower, which later the Turks referred to as a kule. This, of course, was destroyed by the German archaeologist Heinrich Schliemann. We also know that about 1458, the Florentine Antonio Acciaiuoli gave the Acropolis to the Ottoman Turks, and it was they who later transformed the Acropolis into a mosque with a minaret, which was probably, if I'm not mistaken, Esmeralda, as high as the statue of the goddess Athena?
The statue of Athena, yes.
But do you think the Muslims were impressed with that site for worship? I wouldn't think so, right?
Well, if the cupola is missing,
right.
it wouldn't be as important, as significant as other sites.
Yeah. And if you put it all together visually, you've got an ancient temple with Christian additions and now being converted into a minaret, a mosque. And it really visually is a bit distracting. So I could explain why. For most Muslims, it was not a major place of worship. Anyway, let's go.
I do not have the exact date when it was transformed into a mosque. Either it is 4058 or 4060. I'm not sure. Others say probably later.
Okay, let's go further down in time. Tell me some more.
September 26th, 1687. Morosini.
Morosini, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, well, Morosini, I have to say that. Can I just give a little background on this individual?
Absolutely.
Francesco Morosini, one of the famous Morosini family members who later became a doge of Venice. He is a very controversial figure, besides the eccentricity of being dressed always in red from top to toe and never going into battle without his cat beside him. He is the gentleman who bombed the Parthenon during the Sixth Veneto-Turkish War, also known as the Morean War, which you just stated in 1687. Mm-hmm. Just for those listening, and Esmeralda, correct me if I'm wrong, the Ottomans had converted the Acropolis, specifically the Parthenon, into a powder magazine. Morosini landed a bomb into the center of the Parthenon. A very unfortunate moment, which he later on, to explain who Morosini is, when he made his report to the Venetian Senate, he referred to it as a fortunate shot. Morosini also tried to take several items from the western pediment of the Parthenon, but in the process of moving them, he caused them to shatter. What an interesting chap.
Yeah.
He also
put ladders all over.
Yeah. And then he tried to loot the famous Piraeus lion, which he did.
Yeah.
And if you go to the arsenal in Venice, which I had the pleasure of doing recently, mm-hmm. you could see it there on display.
Yes.
A complete mm-hmm. scoundrel. A complete scoundrel. I mean, if we didn't have to talk about the Ottomans coming up next, he would be probably the main focus of our conversation right now. But yeah. So let's go on from there, please. Yes.
1708, the Turks are back.
Yes.
And in 1827, we have another destruction. Kutahis wanted to destroy Acropolis because he was under the impression that the Europeans helped Greece because of its ancient monuments.
And this was during the struggle for Greek independence, everybody, which we just celebrated 2 centuries, the famous Ottoman general Kutahis. Please continue.
That's actually when the appearance of the rock changed. And another very important day to remember, it is April 11th, 1833, when we see the Greek flag again on the Acropolis brought by Capitan Dimitris from Chios, from the island of Chios.
That's impressive. This was, mm-hmm. This was 1833, I'm thinking Bavarian period. This is when the Parthenon was probably under the control of Bavarian troops loyal to the German Christopher Naser, right? Who was guarding
Correct.
The building?
Yes, Christopher
okay,
Naser,
gotcha.
Yes.
That makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And last but not least, Lord Thomas Elgin.
Oh, boy.
He was the British ambassador in Constantinople between 1799 and 1802. And by the end of May 1800, after negotiations with the Turkish authorities, he sent the embassy secretary, William Hamilton, to Athens.
William Hamilton, yes.
Rings the bell?
Of Nelson and Lady Hamilton fame.
That
yes.
is correct.
Go
that
ahead.
Is correct. That's him.
Interesting characters, yes.
Very interesting.
Yes.
So he sent him with Athens with six other people to study the ancient site, make drawings, etc. And for 9 whole months, they were paying the Turks £5 per person to enter the Acropolis. In May 1801, when the French were forced out of Egypt, the relations between the English and the Turks were rekindled. And Elgin was given a verbal permission for excavations. And soon enough, this permission became official. A document by Abdullah Seyed was brought to Athens by Philip Hunt. It did not have the Sultan's signature, though. And according to this document, which was translated into Italian, Elgin's people were allowed to remove stones. Qualche pezzi di pietre. 5 of the 6 people were dismissed, and only the Italian architect Lussiere stayed behind. And so the destruction started.
A tragic
meanwhile,
moment
mm-hmm. meanwhile, when Napoleon terminated the Treaty of Amiens, Elgin was in Milan and was kept there as a hostage between 1803 and 1806. And during these years, Lussiere was exchanging letters with Lady Elgin and was taking orders from her. We also need to mention that the French Consul Fauvel stopped the plundering briefly in 1803 on his country's favor, of course.
Right, right.
And indeed, some antiquities were transported to France in 1807, if I'm not mistaken.
It's unfortunately part of Napoleon's legacy that a lot of plundering of ancient monuments from Egypt to other places he went to was also another reality going on at the same time. Yes, continue.
During the time of this tragic despoiling, many crates left for England. The last shipment of about 80 crates took place in 1811. And the first shipment included 16 crates. The 4 were from William Leake's collection.
Oh, William Leake. Yes.
William Leake, yeah. I think the Greeks called him Capitan Leake or so.
So they gave him the title Capitan Leake, a bit of a admirable nickname, considering this man, under the disguise of a researcher and a scholar, was also doing his very well-rehearsed part, collecting coins and marbles.
Oh, yeah.
And we know that's the case because it was later on that he donated something way beyond coins to the British Museum.
Right. Yes,
so much for
exactly.
Capitan Leake, right? Yeah.
And that first boat's name was Mentor. And it sank on September 17th, 1802. And Elgin was paying divers 500 piastres for each crate recovered from the bottom of the sea. And for as long as the operation lasted, the antiquities were guarded by a boat, and a murder of a peasant who tried to claim a crate is mentioned.
Wow.
Yeah.
There's even a homicide involved. Wow.
Yeah. And of course, as expected, the press quickly turned against Elgin. Lord Byron stigmatizes Elgin in his works Childe Harold and Curse of Minerva. Many others also, Chateaubriand, Clark, Douglas. The outcry against Elgin was so big that he had to portray himself as a savior of the antiquities from the French and the Turks.
Wow.
And he actually kept them until 1815. But in February 1815, negotiations started for the purchase by the state.
Right.
And they were sold for 36,000 pounds in 1816.
Wow. It's a big sum of money. Very big sum of money. Very. Notice how the public relations aspect of this came out to try to salvage his very poor reputation. I mean, if Lord Byron gets his grips on you, you're done. I mean, that's all I know. He has really destroyed some people in his very heavy writing. So I can see why the PR was needed. Okay, continue. Tell me some more about this.
The great Ennio Quirino Visconti was called in England to express his opinion. When he returned to Paris, he wrote his last book in 1818.
And if I'm not mistaken, that was the famous Mémoire sur les fragments de sculpture du Parthenon, de l'Acropole et sur une épigramme grecque. Is that right?
Exactly. This is the book. This is the book. This man was a genius. It is said when he was 3.5 years old, he could read ancient Greek and Latin. And at the age of 13, he translated a Cavi Ripidu into Italian. He was a genius, this man.
Smart man. Very smart man.
Mm-hmm. Visconti mentions that 253 pieces were stolen by Elgin.
Wow.
Also numerous pots, sun clocks, etc. More than 96 whole pieces and fragments from the Parthenon alone. 15 whole pieces and 4 fragments from the southern metope, 11 statues and parts from the eastern pediment, more than 8 from the western pediment, 21 whole marble slabs and a fragment from the northern frieze, 30 whole and 1 fragment from the southern frieze, 2 slabs from the western frieze, and 4 slabs from the eastern frieze. And among the most important is the part of the eastern pediment, which shows the birth of Athena.
Wow.
The metope, which shows the argument between Poseidon and Athena. And the friezes, showing the procession of Panathenea.
Right, the famous Panathenaic friezes. Yes, mm-hmm. Very tragic.
He also took 4 pieces from Naos Apteronikis, 18 from Erechtheion, including 1 Cariatis, which put the stability of the portico in question, 4 from Theatron Dionysus, the one is the Colossus of Vacchos from the monument of Thrasylos, 13 heads, 34 reliefs, 8 altars, 14 copper and marble water carrying hydrias, 3 tombstones, 66 marbles with no inscription. And the irony is that the British Museum sent plaster casts to Greece.
Oh, my God. I mean, I was about to say in a partridge in a pear tree, but this is way beyond 12 items here. This is this is so much. I mean, and then they had the audacity to send the plaster casts. Oh, well.
Yeah.
And is that all?
No. He went on. He took antiquities from Aegina, from Daphne, from Elefsis, from Tiryns, from Nemea, from Mykines. And thank God the lions were too heavy for him to take.
Oh, my God. The two famous lions at the gate of Mycenae. Yes. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Yeah. You mentioned the temple of Apteronikis. I always found that a fascinating title, Apteronikis. Can you explain
it
that?
It is. Apteros means without wings, horistera,
right.
Without wings. Nikki is Athena, is the goddess.
Ah.
And Pausanias writes, they cut off her wings so that the goddess would always remain in Athens.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. That is something else. After all, not only is the wisdom the issue, but also she is a goddess of war. She's not Aries, but she's got a military aspect, and Athens, we discover, definitely from Pericles and on, is constantly engaged in many military conflicts for the next century.
Unfortunately,
you're right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think at that point we should pay tribute to Melina Mercuri
absolutely.
For her struggle for the return of the marbles to where they belong.
Right.
And among others, in 1982, she said, "The day the marbles of the Parthenon will come back to Greece, even if I'm not alive, I will be reborn."
Mm. How nice. That's something. Very nice.
I think also we should remember the wonderful, wonderful pictures taken by Nellis.
Oh, yes. You the remember? Famous Nellis. Yes. Yeah, yes. That black and white photographer. She did some beautiful work.
Beautiful work on the Acropolis.
Yes. I suggest to the listening audience to get a chance, get on the internet, take a look at some of Nellis' photography. Stunning. Very stunning.
Stunning. Oh. And also some movies made on the Acropolis. Sissy. Mm. Boy on a Dolphin. New York Stories, My Life in Ruins, Two Faces of January. And you know, I also remember the studio track by Rai. That must have been April 1963, if I'm not mistaken. They were making a TV production about the golden age of Pericles.
Mm.
And if I remember correctly, the journalist's name was Eric Severide.
Wow, the famous Eric Severide. Wow, yeah. That is amazing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That is some. That's a name from the past.
Yeah.
Wow.
And that must have been April 1963. Yeah.
You just took me back to a Greek Independence Day parade many years ago, sometime in the late 80s, I would say. And I remember Melina Mercouri walking the streets of Fifth Avenue in a very long fur. And the thing that she kept saying is, "Τα μάρμαρα, μη ξεχνάτε τα μάρμαρα." She kept saying, "Don't forget
I
the marbles."
I do remember that, Mike. I remember that.
When you said that, I remember seeing her in my mind again. What an amazing personality she was.
I do remember that moment.
You did mention the Golden Age of Pericles, which is pretty much the context for the building of these amazing constructions, the Parthenon, of course, being the centerpiece. Tell us some more about the role of Pericles, please.
Pericles. As Plutarch writes, he was a skilled speaker with a very, very nice voice. Plutarch writes, "Είχε την ιδίαν φωνήν και εύτροχον και ταχίαν εν το διαλέγεσθε γλώταν." From his father's side, they were honored to protect the Palladion and also the sacred plow of Athena. He was born in 490. And he died in 429. Besides having joined the army and being interested in politics, he was highly educated, music, philosophy. He was a very kind man, honest, very humble. And he did not like official dinners. He did not like gatherings also. And we should not forget that he's the one who built Amphipolis in 437 BC.
The Great Amphipolis, which has been in the news for many years now. Of course, those of you listening know I'm talking about that building that was uncovered in Amphipolis, the tomb, which to this day, there has been no conclusion as to what has been discovered there. But I could tell you, having Pericles' seal on that, what we call an Athenian colony, it has a lot of clout in the ancient world, and it is a very critical location. And as we know, not only for the Athenians, but also for the Macedonians who follow later on. It makes a lot of sense.
Absolutely does. And he's the one who organized the treasury. And before his death, he said, "Every Athenian should remember that nobody starved and during his days, there was no poverty during his days." Hmm. He unfortunately died during the pandemic. And he said, "Our enemies poisoned us. Our enemies poisoned our water."
If I could just clarify for those of you listening, when Esmeralda says pandemic, we're talking about the famous bubonic plague, or just simply the plague of 429 BC, a legendary plague that not only destroyed a major portion of the population of Athens during the second year of the Peloponnesian War, but also deprived Athens of its great leader. Am I right?
Olimos ton Athenon.
That's correct. Yes.
Olimos.
And he lost his sons too, if I'm not mistaken.
Both of his sons from his first marriage died from the disease.
Wow.
His second wife was Aspasia, educated, beautiful. She had impeccable taste. And she has tremendous influence on him. Their son, Pericles, was executed in 406 for failing to pick up survivors following the battle in Arginusis.
What a horrible story.
And the dead bodies as well. A horrible story.
Horrible story. My God. And if I may add, that's where we get the appearance of the great Socrates on the defense council, defending these, I think it was 6 or 7 young men, including Pericles the Younger, who were accused of this.
Yeah.
It's really one of the moments that you say, it's a turning point, I think, for many people studying the war. A lot of people at that point start to feel like maybe Athens has lost the initiative here, clearly, even in a victory. Very sad. Please continue.
And we can see busts of Pericles in the museum in Berlin, in the Vatican, in London. And most probably they're inspired by the statue his friend Chrysilas created.
Oh, yes.
And we see him always with a helmet.
Right.
They say that he was a very handsome and very well-built man, but his forehead was very long, so they had to hide it with a helmet.
Interesting. It's true. You never see him without a helmet.
Without one.
Every statue, there's a helmet. Talk about a little bit of public relations again and vanity. Yeah. I guess nobody wants to have their issues on display, which I can understand. We're living in the age of paparazzi in Hollywood, so I could see that, and politicians do everything they can. But Chrysilas is truly the one who, if I'm not mistaken, created the most famous image of Pericles, right? The one that's the model for all this. And if I'm not mistaken, I think I also might have seen one in the Louvre when I was there a couple of years back.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's just a beautiful, beautiful prototype for all representations of the great Pericles. Tell us something about the foundations of the Parthenon and the Acropolis area, the Acropolis in particular.
In 506 BC, we already have a foundation for a temple. Later, the area was expanded, and they started building the big temple of Athena, but the entire area was burned to the ground by the Persians. But after the Athenian victory against the Persians, their top priority, of course, was to build a temple dedicated to the goddess who helped. Kimon expanded the area and built the southern wall as well. And after another delay, Pericles, already an archon of the Athenian democracy, decides to fulfill the plan in the year 447 BC. The architect was Ictinos, supported by Callicrates and Callimachos. And the artist Phidias would create the sculpture with his two students, Alcamenes and Agorakritos. The style would be Doric. We see Doric temples 5 centuries earlier of Apollo in Corinth and of Hera in Olympia. So we can see how long it took for the Doric style to evolve to the perfection of the Parthenon. The aesthetic and optical rules were first observed by the architect and archaeologist Penrose.
Right,
he's
Francis
the one who
Penrose.
Wrote... Yeah, he's the one who wrote on the orientation of Hecatombedon, which occupied the site of the Parthenon. So, no line is straight for 3 reasons. First, for the rain waters to drain. Second, the strict line seems lifeless. And the third reason is optical. The long straight line looks curved. So the mistake is corrected with the curved line.
Right, right.
Uh-huh.
There's some interesting optical illusion in some way, right? Is that what's being
yes.
implied?
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. The entire temple is made of Pentelic marble. And as we know, the columns are 46, 8 on the eastern and 8 on the western side, and 17 and 17 on the 2 other sides. The corner ones are usually counted twice, so we end up saying there are 50.
Right.
The diameter on the base is wider. It's 1 meter and 90 centimeters. It's about a little more than 6 feet. And at the top, the diameter is 1 meter and 48 centimeters. So it's around 5 feet there. And each column has 20 flutes, which give a sense of even stronger stability and enhance wonderfully the reflection of the light. And Chateaubriand said, Ictinos with the flutes brought the Corinthian lightness on the Doric heaviness and simplicity. We also need to mention that the four corner columns are a little wider because the light takes away from the object, and so they would look thinner.
Right. That's right.
The temple reached an apogee of the ancient art because of the ingenious consciousness and virtuosity of all workers and the collaboration of the architect and the workers resembles that of an orchestra.
I see. Yes. Very well said. Very well said. Can you elaborate on these sections of the Parthenon?
Yes. The western section of the temple was called Parthenon because the maidens dedicated to Athena were residing there. And also this is the area where the treasury was kept. And 10 archons who were elected annually were counting the money and the valuables and writing everything on stone plates. And the eastern section was called Ekatombedon because it was 100 feet long, Ekatopodia, that means around 33 meters. And this is why at the beginning, the entire temple was called Megas Neos, because the western part was called Parthenon and the eastern Ekatombedon. But later on the fourth century, the entire temple took the name Parthenon.
That makes sense. Yeah.
As for the eastern side now, the main section of the temple, the Ekatombedon had actually three sections, the middle one, which was wider, and the right and the left, which were less wide. And the middle one had also three sections, and in the third, the statue was placed. Yes. The statue was 12 meters tall, around 40 feet, and the base was 3 meters, around 10 feet. So altogether, it was 15 meters, around 49 feet. Wow. And as soon as the big doors, which were 10 meter high and almost
5 meters wide,
yeah. 492, yeah, right. Opened, it was shining. Athena's golden tunic was long up to her sandals. Her helmet had a Medusa in the center and two griffins on the sides. And on her chest was the Aegis.
Right, the Aegis.
Yeah, adorned with a Medusa head. And she was holding a golden Nike, the size of a woman, with her right hand, and a spear with her left hand. And her skin was made out of ivory. And on her feet, we could see the Erichthonius. And also the big shield was touching the ground. The diameter was around 5 meters. And the inside of the shield had a written description of the Battle of the Giants, and the outside a relief of the Battle of the Amazons.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. On her sandals was the battle Lapithon and Kendavron. And around the base, the birth of Pandora, attended by 20 gods. And the temple finished in 437 BC, 10 years later. And Plutarch writes about Phidias, Panda in schedon epafto, pandon episkoposin, ke pasin epestati tis technites diaphilian Pericleus. He was in charge of everything because of his friendship with Pericles. Plutarch also writes that Phidias was accused for having his portrait and Pericles' portrait on the shield.
Yeah, charges of blasphemy that had to be in the courtroom. How sad. Esmeralda, thank you so much for this absolutely stunning presentation on the Parthenon and every aspect of it.
I thank you, Mike, very, very much.
It's our pleasure to have you here again, and we look forward to the next opportunity when you can you could teach us so much more about the things that we should know and open up our eyes on some of these astonishing details of things that we take for granted.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you so much.
It's our pleasure. Ladies and gentlemen, there you have it, the Parthenon in all its dimensions. You have been listening to a special edition of Musical Masterworks with your host, Mike Stratis, and his special guest, Esmeralda Mourikis. If any questions, please call at 718-204-8900. I'll be back again in 2 weeks. Until then, have a wonderful night.